Welcome to the session. Yeah, I think it is perfect now. So this is the session number 8. Session number 8 of the money and banking. This is the first chapter that we are covering. After this, we will start with the next chapter, that is public finance and the taxation.
So first of all, if you have any questions for this class, please feel free to ask the questions. If you don't have a question, please type no in the chat box.
Please say something, yes, no. I hope I'm audible. No question. Okay, Rahul. What about others?
Sir, I'm new journey to this channel.
Your good name, please.
New journey to this channel, sir.
Okay, okay. Your good name, please.
Sir?
What is your good name, please? Good name.
Sir, your voice is not clear. Thoda echo aa raha. Okay, so am I audible now correctly? So irrespective of whether you are attending the session for the first time or you have already attended in the previous sessions, it will not matter, because every topic is independent. There is no interlinkage. So you can start with this chapter as well, not a problem. Right. So what are the topics that we'll be covering? In this session, we'll cover nationalization of the banks, small finance banks, recapitalization of RRBs, rediscovering development banks, IBC regulations, merger of the bank, DICGC insurance, advisory board, deposit insurance, and similar things. So we will have a mix of the MCQs. So please read the MCQ on your screen and give the answer in the chat box, right? Try your best, use your common sense. If you are not aware about the topic, you can write an A, not aware, okay? Please type the answer in the chat box. Okay, Srishti. Okay, I think everyone is aware about the answer.
So answer is option A. Now, first, let us see the history of the banking in India. 1865, the first bank was Allahabad Bank. PNB. It was the first, I can say, we can say, Indian bank. 100% was contributed by India. So, who was the person? Who was the person behind PNB? Lala Lajpat Rai. Yes, absolutely. 1906 to 1913, we had various banks: Bank of India, Central Bank of India, Bank of Baroda, Centurion Bank, Indian Bank, Bank of Maharashtra. 1935, we came up with RBI, the central bank. In 1913 to 1948, there were a lot of banking failures. Therefore, to avoid these failures, we brought the central governance in the form of Banking Companies Act and the Banking Regulation Act. These two acts were brought to govern the banks in a much better way. So if we divide the overall phase of the banking sector, first phase, that is the evolutionary phase, is before 1947, till 1947. The second phase is between 1947 to 1968. Then expansion happened in the phase of nationalization, 1960 to 1984. Consolidation happened 1984 to 1990. And in 1991, because of the liberalization, privatization, globalization, there were reforms
which helped bring the private sector banks and the foreign banks into picture, right? So this is how you can see
please go to this slide for the time being.
Can you hear me, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sorry for the interruption. There are some technical issues.
Now we can see the phase 2, 1955 Imperial Bank, then 59 several banks which were owned by the princely state, they came under this SBI, Imperial Bank. Then 1969 the commercial banks, which were nationalized, the first wave of nationalization. 1980, seven banks, they were nationalized. Nationalized means, before 1947, primarily the banking sector was in the hands of the private sector. After independence, we realized that these banking sectors, they were not serving to the farmers, to the lower caste, to the financially weaker people. They were profit-making institutions and they were primarily catering to the economically rich class and in the urban areas. Therefore, in 1969, the first time nationalization was taken, where the ownership of the banks was transferred from the private sector to the public sector. Government kind of acquired. Acquired means government paid the money to the promoters that please take your money and now this bank belongs to us. These are various names of the banks, right? Why this is in news? Because 50 years of nationalization took place in 2019. And also, nowadays, there is a big debate about the privatization of bank and the bank mergers. So if we talk about the privatization of bank, we should also know about the nationalization of the bank. Why at all the nationalization was done and why we are kind of denationalizing now. So banking policy after 1969, we followed multi-agency approach. What is multi-agency? That we established various kind of institutions. We established NABARD, we established RRB, we established commercial bank, we nationalized the commercial bank, right? And we increased the rural bank branches. And we also started priority sector lending. Priority sector lending in any way does not mean concessional lending. The rate of interest in the priority sector lending is not less. Please understand, always keep in mind. The rate of interest in the priority sector lending is not less. It is equal. The only thing is that there is certain minimum amount that is to be given to the priority sector. For example, agriculture, micro small industries, export in exports area, Startup India, like some of the startups, right? Then differential interest scheme. These are one liner, but you know, question can come from these one liners as well. In the recent 2 years, the questions are coming from these two liners. Differential interest rate, it was introduced in 1974. Here the loans were provided with low interest rate to the weakest section among the weakest of the society. Kind of unkyo there, means weakest among the weakest. They were given the low rate of interest in the differential rate of interest scheme. The name itself suggests that there is some differential interest, right?
Okay, there is some problem with the error. I have to manage the camera.
Okay, how is my sound? Okay, thank you. So I'll have to go without camera. There is some problem in the camera, okay? Yeah. So the differential interest rate. Lead bank scheme is that in a particular area, one bank will be managing one district. There can be more than one bank as well, but the particular district will be under the leadership of a particular bank. For example, the district of Ghaziabad will be under SBI, and there will be other banks as well, who will be coordinated by the SBI. For example, the district of, say, Prayagraj, it will be under PNB. So there will be one lead bank and there will be other banks as well. Then regional rural banks. These are the banks which are exclusively working in the rural area in 1975, right? And then the developmental institution, which was dedicated for the agriculture and rural development. That is the NABARD, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, in 1982. This is the name. In the name, it says it is National Bank, but actually it is a developmental institution, right? Whenever there is a word development, it is a developmental institution, which is basically the organization which refinances the banks. It regulates and supervises the cooperative banks and RRBs, right? So cooperative bank plus RRBs, they are regulated and supervised by the NABARD in terms of the functions, in terms of that how much effective they are while performing their duties, right? Otherwise, administrative function, banking function, all those things, they may not be managed by the NABARD, because for the banking we have RBI, and for administration we have, suppose for the cooperative banks, we have the state government or the central government, depending upon which kind of cooperative bank is this, right? So NABARD was instituted, it was established in 1982. This is a developmental institution. 1991, there was a big crisis, right? There was a big crisis. And after this crisis, the banking sector was one of the sector which was reformed drastically. So there were other sectors as well. Suppose there was a foreign sector, export, import. Then we had a banking sector. Right. So banking sector was one of the primary beneficiary of the 1991 reforms.
Banking sector was the primary beneficiary of the 1991 reforms.
They are not audible, sir. Sir, you are not audible.
Voice is not audible.
Hello, can't you hear me? Hello? Okay, I think, sorry.
So after first point, no, we couldn't hear anything till now.
Please type in the chat box. I can't hear you. I think you can hear me. This is the third phase. In the third phase, post 1991 reforms, as per the Narasimhan Committee report, there was liberalization of the banking sector. The foreign banks, they started coming to India. We had the concept of ATM. Earlier, there was no concept of ATM. Even in 2000s, the concept of ATM was not that much popular, right? So you have to go to the bank, you have to wait in the cash line, and then you can withdraw the money. Then we got phone banking and net banking, recently digital banking. And then we talk about the merger of the SBI back with its other associates, as well as the Bharatiya Mahila Bank in 2017. So if you talk about the answer of this question, first bank with the Indian capital was PNB, founded by Lala Lajpat Rai. Merger of banks. Okay, this is factual question. This type of question may not come in the UPSC, but don't worry, just try it out. Okay, Shubham, I'll come to the previous slide, don't worry. Actually, in this question, actually, you may not be aware about the name of the bank, but what is the trick to find the answer? Basically, if you read the term transferee, so what is the meaning of transferee? Suppose we have A and B and C and D. Suppose these four banks got merged and B, C, D, they now merged into A, and the name of the new bank, the merged bank, is A only. So in this case, this A is called transferee. And B, C, D are called transferor. So when merger happens, the transferee will be only one, na? Right? Transferee will be only one. So in this case, if you see option A, B, C, D, this option is possible. Because if there is more than one transferee, then it is not a merger. Right? It is not a merger. So in this case, Bank of Baroda, Vijaya Bank and Dena Bank, they got merged into the Bank of Baroda. Clear, everyone? This is how you can solve this type of question. So actually, here the concept of merger you should know, rather than which banks got merged. Please answer this question. So you're not audible. Okay, am I audible now? Sorry.
Yes, sir.
So, in 1991, Narasimhan Committee recommended a liberalization of the banks. The purpose was to increase the profitability, because till 1991, the banks were having a lot of losses. They were under severe stress because there was a lot of social burden on the banks after 1969 and 1980s nationalization. In 1990, the banks were really under stress. There were a lot of restrictions on the interest rate, on the number of branches they can open, upon the loan giving capability and all of that. So in 1991, these were liberalized. So in 1991, there were a lot of reforms under liberalization, privatization, globalization. And banking sector was one of the primary sector where the focus was on boosting the banking sector by allowing the private sector, by allowing the foreign sector, the foreign banks, right? So you can see the examples like ICICI, HDFC. They are the product of this wave of liberalization of 1991 only. You can see the foreign banks, a lot of foreign banks came into India. Again, this was the impact of these 1991, post-1991 reforms. Right, we have again seen this one. Okay, so this is about the mergers. You don't need to remember the names. Just go through it once. Otherwise, no need to remember the names. Why merger? Because as of now, we have banks, but none of the bank is in the global banks. Our bank do not stand at the international level. So if we merge the banks together, we can create a big bank which can stand as one of the bank in the global market, right? Similarly, there are a lot of duplicate costs. They can be eliminated. Suppose we talk about PNB. There is a bank OBC, Oriental Bank of Commerce, which got merged into it. So in the same city, suppose this is a small city, here we have two branches of PNB, two branches of OBC. Earlier, four branches were operating. Now when OBC got merged, now there are only two branches. So the staff, the rent cost, and the overhead cost, that will be reduced. So it will actually allow the banks to provide the banking services at low cost, which will ultimately help the citizens of India, which will help them connect to the banks. These branches, instead of being in the same city, they can be opened in the villages. So it will help them reach out to the geographically concentrated area, right? They can expand their coverage rather than being located in the same area, the same banks competing for the same market. They can offer more products because now they have big market. They can offer more services now because they have big market, right? It also helps them improving the professional standards, because when size is big, revenue is big, they can invest them for process building, etc., right? And there is a huge competition which is going on unnecessarily between PNB and OBC, for example. And the owner of both the banks are same person, Government of India. And these two children are competing unnecessarily with each other. So rather than competing with each other, they should compete with the private banks or the foreign banks. Right? So answer is Bank of Baroda. I have told you the logic. Here, it is about the merger and acquisition, option B. Competition Commission has given the green channel to expedite the approval of merger and acquisition. See, basically, Competition Commission, it was established so that there is no monopoly, to avoid monopoly, right? To avoid monopoly in the market. So every decision regarding merger and acquisition, it has to be passed by the Competition Commission of India. So this commission will be looking into the decision to merge. Like, is it creating the monopoly? Is it going to harm the consumer at large? And this procedure can take time. But in case of merger of the public sector banks, it is a beneficial decision. And therefore, this specific green channel was announced for the merger of the PSBs by the Competition Commission of India. Okay, because even after merger of the public sector banks, we will still have multiple banks. So there won't be monopoly of the single bank, right? Please read this question carefully. Give your answers. Okay. C, D, C, B. Okay. Okay, so the answer is option B here. Let's see. RBI has announced the final guidelines for on-tap licensing of private sector SFBs. So the payment banks can apply for conversion into a small finance bank after 5 years of operation. What is the difference between payment bank and a small finance bank? We will discuss that very soon. But payment bank into a small finance bank after minimum 5 years, right? Promoter of the payment bank is eligible to set up a small finance bank provided that both banks come under the NOFHC structure. That means in the first case, suppose there is a payment bank Airtel. Now this Airtel want to convert this into the small finance bank. The same bank, the Airtel payment bank. This can be done only after expiry of 5 years. In the second case, suppose the promoter of Airtel payment bank, it also want to establish one small finance bank. It can do so. So there is no requirement of waiting for the 5 years after payment bank is started. Right. But both of them have to come under the same non-operating financial holding company. That means both of these banks, they will be operated under the same company. Suppose this is a company like Bharti Group. Now this Bharti Group is an NOFHC, non-operating financial holding company. Non-operating means this is not into operations. This Bharti Group is not doing any kind of business. This is having financial holding in the Airtel and the SFB. So this is the meaning of non-operating financial holding company. Non-operating means it is not into business, but it is just holding the financial holding. That is the ownership of the Airtel payment bank and the Airtel small finance bank. So the parent company, it's a kind of parent company. This parent company should be the same. This parent company should be the same, right? Then minimum capital requirement for small finance banks has been raised from 100 CR to 200 CR, and the SFBs should be listed within 3 years of reaching a net worth of 500 CR. So what is the meaning of paid up capital? You can say in simple words, I'm not going technical because if I go technical, that will not help you. It is not even required for you. You can just say how much money has been invested by the promoters. This is kind of investors' money. The owner's money. Owner's money, right? So it is minimum 200 CR. And once they become 500 CR net worth company, what is the meaning of net worth? Net worth is basically the, like, simply iski value kitni hai, valuation, company valuation, the financial value of the company, the value of the assets, etc., right? After adjusting for the liability. So it should become, once it becomes 500 CR, then it should be listed. What is the meaning of listing? That means it should be listed in the stock exchange. And what will be the impact of listing? Can anyone tell what is the impact of listing? Why they are asking for the listing at all? What is the impact of listing? Can you please try? What is the benefit of listing? Anyone? Just try it out. Try out. Don't worry about right or wrong. Public ownership and corporate governance. Very good. This will help bring the transparency. Right? This will increase the transparency in the company. Because once it becomes listed, that means Now, all the finances of the company will be shown to the public. They will be in the public domain. There will be decision making involving all the stakeholders. There will be good corporate governance. So a big size small finance bank, it should be listed. It should be listed, right? Fourth, they will be given status immediately upon commencement of operations and will have general permission to open banking outlets from the date of commencement of operations, right? It is not that much important point. The first 3 points are important. You should remember them. What is the meaning of on-tap licensing? Can anyone tell? What is the meaning of on-tap licensing?
Sir, whenever the bank applies for license, they can get it rather than it was earlier like they can do it once in a year or something like that.
What is the meaning of on tap?
Sir, am I audible?
Just keep thinking. Every time, see, economy becomes very, very easy if you start decoding the words. Whatever word come there, if you start decoding the word, economy becomes very, very easy. It becomes fun. So please say yes, no. If you know, then say yes. If you don't know, yeah. So basically, on tap licensing, basically, normally what happened in the past, that government will allow the applications for establishment of bank for a particular time. For example, it will issue a notification that for next 6 months, we are accepting the application for a small finance bank approval. You can take the license of a small finance bank for next 6 months, right? But now they are saying you open a bank or you want to open a bank, you come to us, you fulfill the condition and we will give the license. So it is on tap. On tap kya hota hai ki aapne tap open kiya aur aapka water bahar aa gaya. Tap on tap, okay? Just understand. Tap on kiya, pani bahar aa gaya. Similarly, you apply, you are eligible and you got the license. You don't have to wait for the notification that once the government will notify, then only you can do that. Okay. So this is the meaning. Okay. Yes, absolutely. You are perfect. Prakash, you are right. Now, in this case, option B is incorrect because payment banks are granted immediate license upon payment of fees. This is not true. Now, this question, please read carefully. Okay, tell me, when I am sharing the screen from my digital board, are you using that screen for the class, or if I am on the camera, then you are using that camera screen? Which one helps you better concentrate? Just a survey kind of thing. Did you get my question? So there are two screens. One screen is the digital screen I am sharing from one of the computer. Another screen is the screen coming from my camera in which I am also visible. So which one you are using, which one you are preferring? Digital one. Okay, good. So now tell me, should I use the camera or not? Good question. I know it is very natural that you will be looking into the digital, right? That is why I'm sharing it, because the clarity is very, very good in the digital. But now the question is, should I stop sharing my camera? Should I use my camera or not? Is it required? Camera is required or not? You want to see my faces or not? You like, the question is very simple. Camera is not required. Okay. No, sir, use camera. Okay. Stop camera view. Okay. Required, sir. Okay. So there is a mixed opinion. So why I use camera? Because, you know, otherwise it do not become lively, right? Because we have been reading in the classroom since our childhood. So if we don't see the faculty, after some time we become lethargic. But if we see the faculty in action, we also be active, we also be energetic, right? So I am using a mix of both. Thank you for the feedback. Both are required, okay? Both have given all importances, the screen as well as the camera. Yeah. So in this question, answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Some of the important provisions about a small finance bank. And before that, let me share with you very important thing. That is the difference between the payment bank and the small finance bank. Okay. You should understand this. This should be very, very clear to you. This is very, very important, right? Very, very important. The difference between the payment bank and the small finance bank.
Sir, you're not audible.
Okay, sorry. Thank you for. So the difference is, in case of payment bank, the focus is on the financial inclusion. Here the focus is that if a person is there in the Delhi and want to transfer the money to the village, in village there should be some linkage with the with the payment bank. That will become the life of this person in Delhi very easy, because the branches of the mainstream bank may not be there, right? As compared to small finance bank. In a small finance bank, the primary focus is to provide the services to the small and medium enterprises. So the word small, you can relate with this small and medium enterprises. Basically, small businesses, small household, small, like reaching out to the remote people. And they offer multiple kind of services. Now coming to the payment bank, in the payment bank, they can accept the deposit up to rupees 1 lakh. Because accepting the deposit is not their primary work. They are not the main bank. They are not the mainstream bank. Had they been the mainstream bank, then they would have got the license of mainstream bank. So they will have the limitation of acceptance of 1 lakh. Okay. They cannot lend to anyone. The lending is not their primary business. They cannot earn through lending the money. See, the major source of income of the bank is what? Earning money through giving the loan. They accept the deposit at less rate of interest and give the loan at more rate of interest. The difference between the deposit rate and the lending rate is their profit. But in case of payment bank, this is not true, right? Because they cannot lend. At the same time, they can issue the ATM and the debit card, because the money which has been deposited 1 lakh, they should be allowed to be withdrawn through ATM and the debit cards, right? They cannot give loan, we have seen. They can provide remittances services. like this one, Delhi to village, okay? They can distribute financial services. Yeah. So now how they will be earning the profit? Using other services. They will be, they will become the vehicle for distribution of other services like mutual fund, okay? This work can also be done by the small finance bank. So this is a similarity. Now let us see what is the similarity, what are the differences. So similarity, can issue ATM, debit card and credit card. Here they can issue ATM and debit card. So the difference is credit card. Okay, here they can see in payment bank, credit card cannot be issued because they can't lend. Jab wo loan hi nahi de sakte, to credit card bhi kaise issue kar sakte hain? It is very simple, okay? In small finance bank, they can give the loan, but primarily to the small and medium enterprises and the farmers. The name itself suggests small, okay? They can accept the deposit, right? Because they can provide total banking services. We'll have to ensure 50% of the loan they are given in the form of advance up to 25 lakh rupees. This will put the upper limit because their size is small. Wo limit unka fixed ho jayega kyunki unka size kya hai, small hai, right? They can also provide remittance services. This is a very general operation, right? So small in terms of the customers, in terms of the amount of loan. Yes, they can give the loan, they can issue the credit card, and they can provide the remittance services. They can provide the mutual. So more restrictions are upon the payment bank rather than the small finance bank, right? Now let us come back. These are some of the small finance bank in India. Ujjivan, I have a bank account in this. I run an NGO, and that NGO has account in Ujjivan Small Finance Bank, and there are other banks, right? Now a small finance bank will be given scheduled bank status. Now what is the impact of they having the scheduled status? Can anyone tell? I have already discussed in one of the previous session. Just trying to interlink, just checking your revision thing, are you revising or not? What is the meaning of scheduled? What is the condition? And what is the impact? What is the meaning? What is the condition? What is the impact? Second schedule of the RBI Act, right? Very good. And condition kya hai? Don't worry, Shakti. If you are new, don't, not an issue. Other people can tell. They can avail loan from the RBI. Yes, very good. CRR with the RBI, absolutely. Access to RBI credit flow, have to maintain CRR. Yes. Conditions kya hai? What are the conditions? Some paid up capital is required, right? They have to give the status, financial status to the RBI and all, right? Benefits, they are part of the clearance payment settlement system and all, right? Now, minimum capital for the setting up of a small finance bank has been mandated at 200 CR, right? For primary urban cooperative bank, UCB, to become SFB, the initial net worth requirement is 100 CR and to be increased to 200 CR within five years. So if a urban cooperative bank want to convert itself into the small finance bank, it can do so by having the 100 CR net worth, and within 5 years, it has to convert it into 200 CR, right? So kind of relaxation of 5 years for the urban cooperative banks. Any individual or professional having at least 10 years of experience. So individual or professional like you and me can also open the bank, right? But we should have the minimum experience of 10 years in the banking and finance sector at a senior level, right? So they can set up the SFB either singly or jointly. Promoters of SFB, they shall always hold a minimum of 40% of the paid voting equity capital of the bank during the first 5 years. So this is called lock-in period. This is called lock-in period. What is the logic of lock-in period? Why this? Can anyone tell? What is the logic of lock-in period in this case? What is the logic of lock-in period? Why the government is asking to have a lock-in period? so that they are genuinely into the business. They are not purely investors and playing with the emotions of the customers, the small customers. So that only professional, genuine people who want to do the business in the long term, they come in there. They establish the bank, they establish the practices and all, right? So this is to ensure that genuine people come here rather than getting a license and suddenly selling it to other people, right? 75% PSL, this is important. Priority sector lending, 75% money. 50% loan to below 25 lakh. We have already seen that. Oh, yeah. NBFC, they can also become SFB, right? All of other things we have discussed. So here answer is both 1 and 2. Payment banks, do's and don'ts, we have already discussed. Payment bank structure, 100 CR minimum capital, 75% of the deposit will be done with the government bond. Maintain 25% of with the other banks. So they cannot lend the money. Suppose they receive 100 CR from the deposits of less than 1 lakh rupees. They can accept the deposit up to 1 lakh rupees only. Right? And in this 100 CR rupees, they can invest 75% in the government bond and 25% in the other banks, right? They have at least 26% investment by the Indians, right? They can only accept CASA deposit, current account, saving account. CASA means current account, saving account. They can't accept FD deposits. Long-term deposit ko accept nahin kar sakte. Liability should not exceed 20 times of the net worth. This is not important for you. Have 25% of the branches in the unbanked areas. Where, like, it is not a rural area. Please understand, this is not rural area. Don't confuse. This is unbanked area where there are no bank branches earlier, which is completely bankless area, right? So these are the structure important point. Now, a overall comparison, similarities and the differences between the various banks. Commercial bank, the normal mainstream bank, they can accept the deposit, they can give the loan and they can make the payment. A small finance bank, they can also do all the three tasks. Payment bank, they cannot grant the loan. This is the only difference between the three primarily, right? This is the next question. Please solve this question. D A, okay. So deposit insurance, when a customer deposits the money, suppose Mr. A, he deposits 10 lakh rupees, maybe 5 lakh rupees in the saving account, 2 lakh rupees in the current account, 3 lakh rupees in FD. Suppose SBI fails. It should not happen, right? I'm just taking a hypothetical example. If SBI fail, then our country will collapse because economy is having a big contribution from SBI. So 10 lakh rupees going to three different kind of bank account, saving account, current account, FD. Suppose bank SBI fails, earlier Mr. A will get maximum 1 lakh rupees from SBI as a insurance from DICGC, not from SBI, because SBI to fail ho gaya, uske paas paisa hi nahi hai. Jitna paisa wahan se mil jaye to achhi baat hai, nahi milega to DICGC hoga. This is a kind of insurance company for the bank customers. Jo bank ne apna paisa jama kiya hai unke liye insurance company hai. This DICGC will give 1 lakh rupees to Mr. A. Now this 1 lakh rupees, it was the amount set up in 1993. It is almost 30 years from now, 28 years almost, right? So that is very, very old, very, very, you know, big, big gap. After 1993, there have been more than 28 years, and now it has been increased to 5 lakh rupees. That now Mr. A will get 5 lakh rupees from DICGC, right? Now, please understand one thing. Number one, this amount can lie into any type of account. 10 lakh rupees can be in saving account, current account, FD, or any combination of all these three, or any other kind of deposit also, if there is a recurring deposit or any other kind of deposit, right? Kisi bhi tarah ke deposit hogi bank ke paas mein, wo sabhi aapke insured hoti hai. It is not a insurance only for current account or only for saving account or only for FD or only for recurring deposit. It is for every kind of deposit, right? Number two, who will give the premium? It is the bank, the State Bank of India. Who will give the premium? The bank itself. The premium will be very, very small amount, right? Because the chance of failures are very, very less, right? And this premium will not be shifted to the customer. This premium will not be charged from the customer. This is also important. Aisa nahi hai ki customer se wo charge kar lenge, right? So deposit insurance is providing insurance protection to depositors' money by receiving a premium. The government has set up DICGC under RBI. And every insured bank pays premium of 0.001% of its deposit to DIC every year. Every year, this premium is to be paid. Okay. News mein kyo tha? Budget 2020 mein, this limit was increased from 1 lakh to 5 lakh after the PMC crisis. The government has set up DICGC under RBI and it has decided to increase the insurance cover. Since 1993, this was never raised. DICGC Act will have to be amended and it will increase the bank premium cost, but it will not be passed to the depositors. Why? Who are insured? Who are insured? Okay. All the commercial bank and all the cooperative banks, except in the some of the states, you're not supposed to remember the name. DICGC insures all the bank deposits such as savings, FD, current and recurring. Besides, only primary cooperative societies are not insured by the DICGC. So primary cooperative societies which are working at the village level, they are not insured. Right? They are not insured. DICGC does not include following type of deposit. Deposit of the foreign governments, deposit of the central and state government, interbank deposits, deposit of the state land development banks with the state cooperative bank, any amount on account of any deposit received outside India, and any amount specifically exempted by the DICGC with previous approval of RBI. Means primarily jo government ki deposits hoti hai usko nahi karte hain, because government ko kya zarurat hai yaar, government ko itna kuch khas zarurat nahi hai, theek hai. Government want to save the premium. Monetary Policy Committee, Please read this question carefully. Six members, three by the government. No government official will be nominated. That means the member of MPC will not be the government official, right? The other three members will be from the RBI, with the government being the ex-officio, governor being the ex-officio chairman, right? Governor being the ex-officio means by virtue of the office, whosoever is the governor will be the member, right? Deputy governor of the RBI in charge of the monetary policy will be member also an executive and all, right? They will be appointed for 4 years and shall not be reappointed. So answer is option A, 4 years, not 2 years. Okay, these are some of the direct questions for learning, right? Which among the following organizations recently launched a global consortium for digital currency governance? IMF. Which of the following issues the special data dissemination standard? This is IMF. Sorry, I think the answer is different. I'm not sure about the answer of first. Which among the following plans to phase out fossil fuel financing? European Investment Bank and New Development Bank. Development Bank. What is Development Bank? Development Bank is how, you know, they give the loan. So primarily they are giving the long-term loan, and their financing is also long-term. Long-term capital se long-term loan dete hain. As compared to the commercial bank. So what is the problem in the commercial bank? Suppose we talk about PNB. PNB accept the deposit for 1 year. Deposit accept hoga from the customer, and they will give the loan of 25 years. So this is called mismatch, asset liability mismatch. एसेट लाइबिलिटी मिसमैच. आपने एक साल का लोन लिया, एक साल का डिपॉजिट लिया, 25 साल के लिए लोन दे दिया. व्हाट इफ इन द फ्यूचर समवन कम्स एंड सेज कि मेरा वापस कर दीजिए पैसा, ठीक है? सो दिस इज अ मिसमैच, एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस पीएनबी हैज अ कैपेसिटी, दे कैंट गिव द लोन बियॉन्ड अ लिमिट. बट डेवलपमेंट बैंक इज हैविंग द लॉन्ग टर्म सोर्सेज फ्रॉम इन द फॉर्म ऑफ बॉन्ड. दे विल इशू 25 ईयर्स बॉन्ड, 50 ईयर्स बॉन्ड, एंड दे विल ऑल्सो गिव द लोन फॉर द लॉन्ग टर्म. मेट्रो के लिए, highways के लिए 25 years, 50 years, बहुत long term loan देते हैं, okay? This is the primary difference, and this loan is capital intensive for urban infrastructure, mining, heavy industry, irrigation, power sector, and so on, right? And the rate of interest is also very, very low and stable. Fix है, for example, 1% or 2%, right? Because the main purpose is social benefits. Main purpose is the social benefits. So these are some of the developmental banks, the history of evolution. You can read it later, not that much important. These are some of the development banks: NABARD, SIDBI, IFCI, NHB, Mudra Bank. Recent proposal is to establish one infrastructure and housing project development bank. The focus is on the infrastructure and the housing bank. Okay. So here the answer is option D, World Economic Forum. IMF, SDDS. So what is standard? Standard here is basically the format in which the information will be published. Ye jo data hai, jo information hai, kis format mein publish hogi? This is USS, this SDDS, right? European Investment Bank has phased out the fossil fuel financing. And the answer is option 2 only. So basically, in this case, those RRBs which are unable to maintain the minimum CRAR, what is CRAR? Capital adequacy ratio. They are given the support, right? So, what is the meaning of recapitalization? Recapitalization is the process of RRBs being recapitalized. That is, the capital is being infused again. The capital is being infused again, right? Recapitalization. That is, the owners of the bank, they are again investing the money. Again, putting the money into the banks. That is called recapitalization. So this is done on the recommendations of KC Chakraborty Committee since 2011. NABARD, who is the regulator of RRB, will identify those RRB who are not able to maintain the minimum CRAR of 9%. So CRAR 9% is based on the Basel norms. If they are not able to maintain this, then they are identified by the NABARD and they are given the financing, right? They are given the financing. They are given the loan. So here the answer is option A. So with this, I complete today's session. If you have any question, please feel free to ask the question. With this, we are completing the money and banking today. There can be very, very small concepts which I have given in the notes. Those notes are in the channel of economy, right? The PDF notes. And we will give the notes from the month of June, July, August, after the first week, okay, of September. Almost one month from now, we will give the 3 months notes. But primarily, every year I have identified that if you maintain your hold over the basic things, if you maintain the hold over the basic things, it becomes very, very easier for you for you to solve the questions, because the questions, they come from the logical background. The questions, they come from the conceptual background, right? So even if you don't follow the current affairs of the very, very recent time, still you can get very good marks if you follow the current affairs of last 2 years, right? So this is how you can do. Any questions before we complete the session?
feel free to ask the question. Thank you very much, everyone. Next chapter. Which chapter should we start? Should we start external sector or should we start public finance? Which chapter you want to get started? Public finance. Okay. Public finance is very, very easy. Not a problem. We will try to complete in maximum 2 to 3 classes. Maximum 2 class. मुझे लगता है ज्यादा नहीं होगा. काफी इजी चैप्टर है. ठीक है. मुझे लगा था आप बोलेंगे एक्सटर्नल सेक्टर, क्योंकि पब्लिक फाइनेंस तो मैं काफी बार पढ़ा चुका हूँ आपको. मेंस में मैंने डिस्कस किया है. देन आई डिस्कस्ड इन द इकोनॉमिक सर्वे. एनीवेज आई विल कम विद द पब्लिक फाइनेंस. थैंक यू एवरीवन. नेक्स्ट क्लास विल बी प्रोबेबली ऑन मंडे शायद. या मोस्ट प्रोबेबली मंडे. Evlo chapter, Modi, Churu, Kinga. Sir, what is this? Shakti, I didn't get your point. I don't understand your language. Okay, thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Take care.